everyone, welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be talking about my top reads from 2022. According to my Goodreads profile, I read 59 books in 2022, which is a big increase over how many I read in 2021, where I only read 34 books. I can attribute this directly to having renewed my county library card, which opened up a lot of possibilities for me in terms of checking out ebooks. So what I've done for today, I've gone through my entire list of 59 books and categorized them into genres, took my top three genres and picked my favorite book from each of those, and then one freebie from everything that didn't fit into those genres. So we're going to be talking first about romance, then about sci-fi fantasy, then about cozy, which isn't a real genre, but I put it in there, and then we'll have our last freebie book. So to kick things off, we're going to be starting off with romance. So romances. I categorized about half of my books that I read in 2022 as romances, and most of these are contemporary romances. This year I only read three historical romances, unlike last year when I read the entire Bridgerton series in a 2-week period and did not get anything else done. My favorite romance this year that I read was Book People by Emily Henry. Nora, the main protagonist in Book People, is your stereotypical city girlfriend from a Hallmark movie or from any other romance, you know, genre book. She likes her job, she's very good at it, she's very ambitious, she likes working out, she loves New York City, and she's had a string of boyfriends in the past who have, for one reason or another, gone to a small town and subsequently broke up with. So the book kicks off when Nora's younger sister convinces her to join her on a month-long small-town adventure. And this is obviously the premise for Nora's own Hallmark story, complete with getting her hair changed, a sexy local, finding a small business that needs saving, all of these things coming together. What I really loved about this book, first of all, of course, was the premise, taking this cliche and flipping it on its head, doing something very different with it. But what really took it the extra mile was that Henry uses this premise not just to examine the cliche and all that kind of thing, but also as a jumping off point for talking about family ties, sisterhood, complicated grief, how actually complicated relationships are in the real world, and how romance novels often gloss over the complexities of a real relationship in the real world with all of the other complications that we have in our lives. So it was a very, very good book. I highly recommend it. And then my runner-up for romance novel that I read in 2022 was Love on the Brain by Allie Hazelwood. My second genre for the day today is sci-fi fantasy. And I chose a sci-fi book from my 11 books that I've read in the sci-fi fantasy genre this year. The reason I love reading sci-fi books is I find that the world building really sticks with me for a long time. It gives me a lot to think about and kind of play with in my mind long after I finished reading the book. So I've picked a book this year that really did that for me. The book that I chose for this year was The City in the Middle of the Night by Charlie Jane Andrews. This was not published this year. It was published a few years ago, but I read it for the first time this year. The book takes place in the far future. Humans have colonized a planet. This planet is tidally locked, which I had to look up to understand. What it means basically is that the same part of the planet always faces the sun. So if the sun's here, like the same part is always you can look up a science blog if you want to understand the intricacies of tidally locked planets, but essentially what it means is that half of the planet is always facing the sun. That part is very hot and uninhabitable. The other half of the planet is never facing the sun. that part is freezing cold and also uninhabitable. So humans have settled in two cities along the center kind of twilight zone, where in the only habitable zone on this planet. And as a result of living in this perpetual twilight, these two cities have developed their own cultures and their own practices for dealing with day and night and kind of time and how rhythms of life work. This book was honestly not very pleasurable to read. It's gritty, it's a little bit depressing. The characters are nuanced people, they make bad decisions, bad things happen to them that are out of their control and that were in their control. The ending isn't like particularly satisfying, it doesn't wrap things up nicely, but what it does do is give you a lot of different, very interesting world-building things to think about. And I did think about it for a long time. So my runner-up for this category was also a sci-fi book that gave me a lot to think about, Hail Mary by Andy Weir. This is a very popular book this year. Third category, the third genre that we're going to talk about today are cozy books. In my mind, these books are books that are uplifting and positive, but don't have another genre as their main storyline. So a cozy mystery is a mystery that is uplifting and positive and accessible and fun. A romance generally has a romance as its main storyline while being uplifting, sentimental, accessible, and fun. These are books that are just fiction that are uplifting, positive, fun, but don't have a true other genre as their main storyline. My pick for this genre for this year is Iona Iverson's Rules for Commuting by Claire Pooley. This book takes place in England on a commuter train where the cast of characters of the book meet as strangers and throughout the events of the course of the book become friends. What I really liked about this book was its portrayal of the spectrum of human relationships. We as humans have a lot of different nuanced ways of relating to one another, and this book really covered a lot of those different ways in a way that was uplifting and accessible and fun. Did I have anything else to say about that? No. My runner-up book in this category was Other Birds by Sarah Addison Allen, which I did a whole reading vlog on if you're interested in more about that book. And now we're up for our last category, which is my other category. Our last book for today is taken from all of the books that didn't fit nicely into one of those first three genres. For me, that included some mystery, some nonfiction, the Inheritance Game series, which I do not know how to categorize. And my pick for this set of books is A Sign for Home by Blair Fell. This is a coming-of-age story which follows Arlo, a young man who is deafblind. The story begins when he enrolls in a community college class with a new interpreter, and with the new interpreter's help, he begins to question some of the things that he had taken for granted. This book, similar to a cozy book, was positive and accessible. What I really liked about this book is it introduced me to a lot of things about deafblind culture, lifestyle, and etiquette. The author of the book has been an ASL interpreter for many years, and although I couldn't find a review of this book by someone in the deaf or deafblind community, it came across as very respectful and accurate without seeming like an educational pamphlet about how to interact with a deafblind person. If I'm going to be nitpicky, the writing in this book was not quite as strong as my other choices for the year, but the content more than made up for it. what this book has in common with the other three books that I picked this year is that I found myself thinking about this book long after I had put it down. And that, for me, is what makes a really excellent book. And that's all I have for you today. Thank you all for joining. I wish you a very happy new year and an amazing 2023 filled with great reads. Thank you, everyone. Bye.